As we can see, the requirements for the design, installation, and operation of hydrogen fueling stations are primarily the jurisdiction of local fire and building departments. There is good news for those of us learning about this technology for the first time. Hydrogen fueling station requirements are now very well covered by codes, regulations, and standards, thanks to the practical experience of the early pioneers. Today's regulators and developers have all the tools and guidelines they need to successfully plan a station right now. The California Fire Code refers to a National Fire Protection Association document, NFPA 2, Hydrogen Technologies Code. This document contains most of the hydrogen fueling station specific requirements. These are found in Chapter 10. But before we get into NFPA 2, let me give you an introductory overview of how a hydrogen fueling station works. Hydrogen fueling stations really are not too complicated. They consist of a few basic elements: hydrogen storage, hydrogen compression, and hydrogen dispensing. Some stations also generate hydrogen on-site. The majority of the stations have only gaseous hydrogen storage. All stations provide gaseous hydrogen dispensing. The hydrogen is dispensed at high pressures, 10,000 psi, and stored at even higher pressures, up to 15,000 psi. Larger capacity stations have both liquid and gaseous hydrogen storage. The liquid is vaporized and compressed into high-pressure storage vessels. Some stations produce hydrogen on-site through either an electrolyzer or reformer that converts natural gas into hydrogen. However, for both of these on-site production technologies, gaseous hydrogen storage is required. In summary, all stations at their core are high-pressure gas storage facilities which dispense gaseous hydrogen. Now, let us get familiar with the most specific reference standard in this regard, which is NFPA 2. The purpose of this code shall be to provide fundamental safeguards for the generation, installation, storage, piping, use, and handling of hydrogen in compressed gas form or cryogenic liquid form. This code shall apply to the production, storage, transfer, and use of hydrogen in all occupancies. Provisions apply to the production, storage, transfer, and use of hydrogen in all occupancies and on all premises. NFPA 2 includes fundamental requirements for hydrogen in both gaseous and liquid phases and contains additional use-specific categories, such as vehicle fueling facilities, systems for fuel cell power and generation, applications involving combustion processes and special atmospheres, and operations in the lab. These requirements are enforced by the fire service using the 2013 International Fire Code's Chapter 23, Motor Fuel Dispensing Facilities and Repair Garages, and Section 2309, Hydrogen Motor Fuel Dispensing and Generation Facilities. 43 states have adopted modified versions of the 2013 International Fire Code. The most specific requirements are to be found in Reference Standard NFPA 2, 2011, Hydrogen Technologies Code. Station requirements are found in NFPA 2's Chapter 10, Gaseous Hydrogen Vehicle Fueling Facilities. Building code requirements exist, in a general sense, within the building, mechanical, and electrical codes. These mandates are usually not fueling station specific. NFPA 2 contains valuable information for building departments regarding their review and inspection of hydrogen fueling stations. Coordination between the building and fire departments is essential in establishing appropriate plan review and inspection responsibilities. A station hazard analysis developed by experienced engineers is required. Standardized station designs would not require a repeat analysis. However, unique site-specific conditions may involve additional hazard considerations. Normal fuel station requirements still apply. Emergency shutdowns, extinguishers, warning signage, dispenser protection such as raised curbs or crash posts, etc. Hydrogen specifics involve the consideration of a highly compressed flammable gas. The concerns may also involve a flammable cryogen. Some stations produce hydrogen by a natural gas reformer or by an electrolyzer that separates hydrogen from water. Fuel transfer surfaces must be able to dissipate vehicle static electricity. This is a concern as hydrogen has a low ignition energy. A flame detector is required at the dispenser because hydrogen, a carbon-free fuel, burns with a barely visible flame in sunlight. Gas detectors are required at the dispenser and within equipment enclosures. Dispenser gas and flame detection is also vital, as hydrogen is non-odorized. Equipment listings and approvals must be appropriate for high-pressure hydrogen. The high pressure and hydrogen's ability to penetrate many materials compels very rigid requirements. Previous experience with CNG stations is an asset, although CNG pressures are lower and LNG cryogenic temperatures are higher. Hydrogen stations require multiple compressors and storage tanks capable of sustaining the high pressure, 10,000 PSI, storage required by the latest fuel cell vehicles. A refrigerant cycle is also used so that the compressed gaseous fuel is within a safe temperature for the vehicle's carbon composite storage tanks. These high-pressure gas systems require safety relief valves, burst disks, pressure sensors, vents, etc. They have similarities to refrigeration systems, but unlike those systems, the mechanical code does not address hydrogen stations. Mechanical elements, such as tanks, valves, pressure relief devices, tubing, hoses, and dispensing devices, are among the equipment covered in NFPA 2's Chapter 10. Unless there is agreement between the building and fire departments as to who will review and inspect the mechanical elements of these stations, it would be the fire department's responsibility for those functions. Now I am going to go through some of these requirements. I just want to make it clear I am not going to cover everything the project is subject to, but some of the more important requirements. I am going to break my discussion of NFPA 2 into the following areas that cover the hydrogen storage and dispensing system. System approvals, component qualifications, storage, piping, pressure relief and venting, maintenance, compression, dispenser operation, electrical, fire safety, vehicle protection, safety devices, liquid storage. Section 10.2 requires a qualified engineer to provide documentation showing that the station design meets the code requirements. Section 10.2 also requires a hazard analysis. Section 10.3.1.1 provides the major systems and components that require listing or approval. The applicant must demonstrate that their systems and components are suitable. Section 10.3.1.3 provides design requirements for the hydrogen containers. Note that setback distance requirements are found in section 7.3.2.3.1.2. Section 10.3.1.7 addresses fuel line and piping requirements. These systems must comply with either ASME B31.3 or B31.12, depending on pressure. They should also be labeled according to ASME A13.1. Sections 10.3.1.4 through 10.3.1.6 provide requirements for the pressure relief components of the system. Note the pressure relief devices. The vent stacks for the pressure relief devices should be designed in accordance with CGA G-5.5, and the pressure relief devices should also meet CGA S-1.1, 1.2, or 1.3, depending on the storage design. Compressors are addressed in 10.3.1.13. Note that compressors should be designed to shut down in the event of a power outage or when an emergency shutdown device is activated. Section 10.3.1.11 sets maintenance requirements. Hoses, nozzles, and breakaways must be examined monthly or according to the manufacturer's instructions. Controllers must verify system pressure integrity. Key requirements include automatic system shutdown when a complete fill is achieved. Vehicle fuel tanks shall not be subjected to 125% of their marked service pressure. Warning signs must be placed at the dispenser. The dispenser hose must be designed and tested according to 10.3.1.8.2 and 10.3.1.8.3. Dispenser setback distances are found in table 10.3.2.3.1.3. Table 10.3.1.16.1 provides electrical classification zones. Section 10.3.1.19 sets requirements for portable extinguishers according to NFPA 10. Section 10.3.1.12 sets a performance-based protection requirement for all station equipment. Emergency shutdown devices must be located according to 10.3.1.18.5. Breakaway devices are required on dispensers as per 10.3.1.18.6. A liquid hydrogen storage system at a station provides a greater quantity of fuel so that more cars can be refueled. Cryogenic or liquid storage systems are different than gaseous hydrogen storage systems. Hydrogen liquefies at minus 423 degrees Fahrenheit to keep it from vaporizing, which requires highly insulated vacuum storage. A cryogenic storage system is really two tanks, an inner vessel containing hydrogen and an outer vessel or vacuum jacket to prevent heat transfer from the inner liquid hydrogen vessel. Chapter 8 of NFPA 2 sets requirements for the liquid storage system. Chapter 11 sets requirements for liquid dispensing, although at this time, no companies are installing liquid hydrogen dispensers. Key requirements for the liquid system construction include 8.3.2.1.4.1 and 8.3.2.1.4.2. The tanks have to meet ASME, Boiler and Pressure Vessel Code Section 8, Division I. Setback distances are found in Table 8.3.2.4.5.1. Section 8.3.1.2.5 sets requirements for vaporizers. Key requirements include a shutoff switch to prevent liquid hydrogen being discharged from the vaporizer. Some additional noteworthy points are on-site hydrogen generation equipment is also not regulated by the mechanical code. Electrolyzers are subject to approval and listing per NFPA 2. Reformers must have a third-party certification. Standard electrical requirements must comply with NFPA 70, the National Electrical Code. However, NFPA 2 hydrogen fueling station electrical equipment classifications and area extents take precedence over NFPA 70. Gas detection is required at the dispenser and also at enclosed storage and compressor equipment. Most other building department issues involving structural seismic requirements, building construction, plumbing supply and drainage, electrical power and lighting, etc., are to be found in general code provisions. NFPA 2 ventilation provisions are a rare issue, as enclosed storage and compression facilities are not a common station feature. We have discussed new station issues. Once stations are operating, annual permit requirements must be met, which is what we will discuss next.